Hello, and welcome to this first video where I'm going to be explaining something regarding social science. So, on popular demand, I'm going to be explaining the chapter 5 of Geography, Class 10th, which is titled Minerals and Energy Resources. So, this is considered to be one of the toughest chapters in the Geography textbook, which I completely agree with you. It is one of the toughest chapters because there's a lot of content. But I'm going to be making it as easy as possible for you. So we're going to be forming some acronyms. We're going to be learning a lot in this chapter. So basically, this chapter is going to be covered in four parts. The first part is going to be the introduction of what exactly a mineral is, along with the mode of occurrences of minerals. The second part is going to be that of the ferrous and non-ferrous, and also the non-metallic minerals, so different types of minerals basically. The third part is going to be that on conservation of minerals, a very short one. And the fourth one is going to be on sources of energy. So, I hope you enjoy watching these videos. But before I start, I would request you to please like this video and subscribe to this channel to receive regular notifications. We use so many, you know, accessories in our day-to-day life. But we often forget about what is the basis of that accessory. For instance, we use a pen every day, right? But we often don't look at how this pen was made. For instance, the name of this pen is made of a mineral called tungsten. So, you know, everything has a basis to it. And minerals are the basis of nearly everything we use. So what is a mineral? A mineral is a homogeneous, naturally occurring substance with a definable internal structure. Which means that it is a naturally occurring substance and is homogeneous, which means that the atoms and ions are, you know, not heterogeneously placed. They are homogeneous in nature, which means they are pretty much equidistant to each other. And also along with that, there's a definable internal structure. The structure is very much defined, so you cannot alter that. So that is a mineral. Now these minerals are usually embedded in rocks, and only after you can, you know, you mine very deep can you actually find these minerals. So they're embedded in rocks, and the very nature of minerals, that is, you know, how the mineral is, whether it's soft. Softest mineral is talc and the hardest is diamond. So the hardness or softness or its color, its luster, everything is determined by the physical and chemical conditions that that particular rock, that particular mineral has undergone. So that is what determines the nature of that particular mineral. So what are the mode of occurrences for these minerals? Like, how do we exactly get to know that there's a mineral somewhere? Or where are these minerals found in simple words? Well, these minerals are found in the form of ores. Now, these ores may be, you know, a combination of many minerals or a combination of minerals and other substances. Now, the removal of the mineral from the ore, the process is called as smelting. And there are basically, you know, they have described five ways how minerals occur naturally. So, the first occurrence, the first mode of occurrence is specific to metamorphic rocks and igneous rocks. And I'm sure you would have heard about it, how they are formed, how the molten magma, when it comes down and solidifies, that's when these rocks are formed, the igneous rocks are formed, and when they further, over a period of time, metamorphosis takes place and the metamorphic rocks are formed. So now, what happens is, minerals in metamorphic and say igneous rocks are found in the cracks and crevices. The smaller ones, the smaller cracks are called as veins, and the larger ones are called as lodes. So remember, LL, lodes, right? So that way, these minerals basically are found in molten or gaseous state deep below, and they are pushed upwards through cavities. And this is specific to metallic minerals. So metallic minerals like tin, zinc, lead, all of these minerals, you know, they are formed by the igneous. What about sedimentary rocks? In sedimentary rocks, the minerals are found in beds or layers. So they are found basically horizontally, in horizontal strata, because of, you know, intense, you know, accumulation and deposition over a long period of time. They are found in these strata, and these minerals are specific, you know, like iron ore and also coal. So all these minerals are found, and they are called as sedimentary minerals also. So moving on to the next one. Now the third one is found because of decomposition of surface rocks. Now, there are many rocks present on the surface, and when they decompose, and only, you know, a mass of weathered material, which means the mass that is easily moved away, those have the maximum content of minerals, these, you know, are left above. Now bauxite, which is basically an ore of aluminium, that is found in that manner. Now the fourth mode of occurrence is that which is found in alluvial deposits, and these are often called as placer deposits. Now this is specific to very very precious minerals like gold, silver, platinum, and they are basically formed on the sands of valley floors or in the base of hills, and they are resistant to corrosion by water. They don't get corroded easily, and you know about that. Gold and silver are very, very resistant to any kind of external forces acting on them. Now moving on to the fifth one, that is of ocean water. Now ocean water, you all know, has a lot of salt content in it, and that's what, you know, facilitates the coming of common salt, and also that of magnesium and bromine. Now there are manganese nodules also found deep, you know, in the seabed. So this is how even ocean water plays a role in extraction of minerals. Now when we talk about India, the resources, the mineral resources, are pretty much unevenly distributed. This is because, you know, in the northern plains, you all know that it's regarded for its agricultural productivity. So not too many minerals of economic significance are found over there. But the Deccan Peninsula and the whole central region, and the states of especially the states of Jharkhand and Bihar and Chhattisgarh, they're all, you know, ripe with a lot of mineral content. So what determines the, you know, economic viability of any reserve? Now there will be many places where you'll find these minerals, but what determines the economic viability? There are three reasons to that. The first one is the concentration of mineral in any ore. Now if it is not very significant, then it does not have any, you know, major impact as such, but the concentration of mineral in an ore is very important. Second one is its closeness to the market, which means how close it is to the market so that it becomes viable. And the third one is how easy is it to extract the mineral from the ground. If it's too deep, then it becomes, you know, to get other machines and all, which is of course going to take a hit on the economic situation. So that is, these are the three things that determine how a mineral reserve will turn into a mine. So I hope you enjoyed this video. Look forward to part 2, where we'll be discussing about ferrous, non-ferrous and non-metallic